Members, the next item on the order paper is a motion on alcohol-related crime. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly recognises the proven link between crime and the overconsumption of alcohol and calls on the Minister of Justice to work on a joint strategy with the Minister of Health that will aim to deliver a targeted outcome of significantly reducing alcohol-related crime.
Thank you. I call Mr. Alex Easton to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to move the motion. Everybody knows and accepts that there is a proven link between crime and the overconsumption of alcohol. I'm hoping this House will today maybe put aside any differences.
Order. Sorry. Can I ask members to leave the chamber quietly and show some respect to the remaining debate and the speakers?
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm hoping this House will today maybe put aside any differences and unite to address what is quite a serious issue that affects our society, our health service, our justice system, our economy and many people's lives. Nobody for sure can say how much money is spent by government either at Westminster or here in Northern Ireland trying to tackle the health problems and indeed the problems we have in tackling crime due to the overconsumption of alcohol. However, from information that we do have suggests that figures from the Institute of Economic Affairs for England and Wales found that alcohol-related crime costs government nearly £1 billion a year, while other such drinking offences adds another £627 million, making total cost to the police and criminal justice system in England and Wales £1.6 billion. The Institution of Economic Affairs has also calculated drink-related problems linked to health problems cost the NHS in England and Wales another £1.9 million. This includes £984 million in hospital admissions and £530 million on alcohol-related treatments, such as when they attend accidents and emergencies. In Northern Ireland, the figures that we have been able to research suggest that the cost of alcohol abuse to the criminal justice system is around £320 to £340 million, although I would be happy to be corrected if there's any up-to-date figures on that. £150 million is incurred by health treatments and an estimated cost to the Northern Ireland economy, it is estimated that that is around £900 million. Some startling facts and figures for Northern Ireland include that 44% of all the arrests made by the PSNI in a single year were as a result of the factor of alcohol. Sadly, 300 deaths were caused by drink in 2012. Two-thirds of violence between strangers involved alcohol. One-third of domestic violence occurred after drinking. 13% of threats to kill involved alcohol. In research carried out by Graham Hetherington, a university professor at Teesside University, showed that three-quarters of people in the criminal justice system have a problem with alcohol. Figures are wide and varied on the issue of the link between crime and the overconsumption of alcohol. However, we know it is a factor, and we need to look at what can be done to help deal with this huge problem that we have in our society. Let's look at what strategies we currently have with the Department of Justice and the Department of Health. The Department of Health, for instance, since 2005, have led the development of a cross-sectoral strategy that has sought to reduce the harm related to both alcohol and drug misuse in Northern Ireland. This was launched in 2006, entitled the New Strategic Direction for Alcohol and Drugs. This was to be a five-year plan aimed to try and change culture and behaviour. It was agreed, rather than undertake a full new strategy development process, that the existing new strategy direction for alcohol and drug plan would be revised and extended until 2016. Under the NSD, four advisory groups provided advice and gave policy guidance, these including groups such as children, young people and families, treatment and support, binge drinking, law and criminal justice. The function of the groups is to feedback to the NSD. The Health Service has also established a liaison group with input from the Public Health Agency, and they meet to monitor overall progress against the NSDS targets and outcomes. We see from the figures from the new Strategic Direction for Alcohol and Drugs Phase 2 that there appears to be some limited success in tackling alcohol and drug abuse, but there are also worrying trends that have increased. For example, adults' drinking patterns have stayed the same since 2005. Problem drinking has increased slightly since 2005. Lifetime use of illegal drugs has increased from 2002 from 20% to 28%. People in treatment for alcohol misuse has risen from 3,074 in 2005 to 3,891 in 2014. This is really, really worrying. On the justice side, the previous minister published the Building Safer Shared and Confidence Community document. We see in it a section on alcohol-related crime, the new strategic direction for alcohol and drugs. We see the costs explained in the document to the Northern Ireland economy and the impact on our society, from the crime in local neighbourhoods to the corruption affecting the effects of organised crime, the health risks to the individual, families, friends and communities and society as a whole, who are all affected. This has led to the overworkings of this, with the aims of support for young people and families dealing with alcohol misuse, increased public confidence and their impact on local communities, supporting offenders with targeted services, ensuring effective powers are available. These are all well and good with good aims, but in reality, are they working? In my opinion, they are best keeping the situation at a similar level, but not making huge differences. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, while there is cooperation between the Department of Health and Justice with reports, strategies and documents and well-meaning soundbites, the facts remain we are not getting on top of the problem related to alcohol consumption and the effects of that. This problem is costing Northern Ireland £900 million a year. It is affecting our health service. It is affecting our justice system. It is affecting our economy. It is affecting the lives of our people. We need to find a better way to reduce these costs. We need to find a better way to deal with the health effects. We need to find a way to reduce the crime caused by alcohol, which is why I'm asking this House today to back our motion, which proves the link between crime and the overconsumption of alcohol, and calls on the Minister for Justice to work on a joint strategy with the Minister of Health that will aim to deliver a better targeted outcome of significantly reducing alcohol-related crimes. We need a new strategy between the two departments, which gives annual reports, actual actions and clear results. We owe this to our people to make their lives and our society better for all. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr. Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I stand to welcome this motion and I support this motion, and it's good to see that the Justice Minister is here today and to listen to this, and I did see the Education Minister, but he's probably just about to shoot off. But I believe he's got a part to play in this also, although not named in the motion. I have to say from the outset that this motion states the obvious, and I don't mean that in a detrimental way. I mean that in we have a societal problem with alcohol, and that societal problem, I think, is well known and is well documented. So that's why I say it states the obvious, and I think tackling it as well needs up a joined-up approach. And in general terms, I think it is pretty obvious what we need to do as well. So where do we really start? Well, do we start with the availability of alcohol and the low cost of alcohol, what you can buy in your local supermarket incredibly cheaply? And that's certainly an issue for society. Do we have a look at the effects on the individual of alcohol abuse, which drives them towards crime, trying to get a hold of alcohol on a day-to-day basis, pretty much like they would do with drugs? Or do we look at the cost to the public purse of alcohol-related issues, and it's already been said exactly how much it costs, and I won't go through that. Or do we look at the crime statistics dealing with alcohol-related crime? With 76% of all those arrested have taken alcohol. 20% of all crime is alcohol related, and that rises to 47% for those which is offences against the person. That's violent crime. And they're huge statistics that we should all be ashamed of in society, to be perfectly honest. But what I would like to do, if you don't mind, please, is just look at this from a victim's point of view, because there's an anger out there when we just don't look at the victim. And let's look at Enda Dolan, 18 years of age, first year student at Queen's University, killed by a hit and run driver on the Malone Road in October 2014, left lying at the side of the road like a bag of rubbish. A shocking crime, a shocking waste of life. The man who was convicted for his murder was convicted for death by dangerous driving and was awarded 7 years, 3.5 on licence. That was increased to 4 by 12 months, and I think we all know that. But why was that death by dangerous driving? Why was that not murder? Why was that not at least manslaughter? Because that driver took 13 drinks when he got into that van. He knew what he was doing. And when he climbed into that van, he turned it into a weapon, just as much as if he was carrying a gun or if he was carrying a knife. And we really have to look at that, because people are angry. And if somebody deliberately drinks and drives, then there's a chance that there's going to be a fatality. Over Christmas, 380 people were arrested for drink driving. That's 380 potential fatalities. So I mention that because we do have a problem with alcohol abuse, and I know I've narrowed it down to drink driving, and you know, we could talk about other aspects of it. But we have alcohol-related crime, and I've already said it is a societal issue. And I've got to say, I do not believe it's just for the Justice Minister and for the Health Minister. I think it's for the executive, whatever shape or form it's going to take in the coming months, dare I say, the coming years, to tackle this as a problem, because we have to target schools, school children. We have to target the workplace, and we have to target communities. Let's tackle how alcohol can grab an individual and destroy their life, and also the fact that drinking alcohol and alcohol abuse and binge drinking is, for some people, a lifestyle choice. They do it, and they do it deliberately, and they fund it by crime, and it's important that we look at those aspects as well. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion. However, I'll come to it in that I'm not exactly sure it's the right proposal going forward, but I do think the sentiment behind it is to be applauded, so thank you for bringing it this evening. I represent the South Belfast constituency, and I'm sure others will say it in this chamber as well this evening, but I do think that my constituency has a particular problem with this, as it covers part of the city centre and a lot of the points on the arterial routes where there is a concentration of licensed premises and leisure locations. And unfortunately for us as a constituency, whilst the problem is concentrated there, a lot of the people who are involved in the alcohol-related crime do not necessarily reside there. So this has a detrimental effect on the residents that I represent. The residents, the workers, and even in some cases the health provision in healthcare in the local hospitals, for example. The reality of it is that as the drunk individuals and the crowds move throughout the South Belfast constituency, they disturb the settled communities, and people will know the geography of South Belfast in that you would have the markets and Lower Ormo and Sandy Row and Donegal Road. And the people who live in a lot of those houses are frail, elderly, have young children, people who would be particularly susceptible to be frightened whenever they would hear a bottle smashing in their front garden, or a wingmower knocked off their car, or any other damage to their property. And so they are the ones, in short, they are the ones who bear the brunt of the disturbances that the drunk individuals and their friends bring onto this constituency. Then we have the extreme cases of alcohol-related crime, and I'm talking about things like actual bodily harm, where individuals or groups have got involved in fights outside bars, and there's somebody who inevitably needs hospital care. What in turn happens then is that the ambulance crew have to come there, take the individual who's been injured, whether they're an innocent victim or not. They have to go to the emergency department, and the already under pressure staff, the doctors and nurses and frontline workers, they are already under pressure, and they have to direct their attention away from maybe people who are maybe more needing. I would like to put on record at this point a commendation to the PSNI for their One Punch campaign. People will know this is a video campaign that they take out into youth clubs and schools and community groups, and that's really about getting the message across that it can just take one punch to be fatal. I would also commend the likes of Queen's University and the University of Ulster, who, despite some issues around disturbances in the Holy Lands, they have proven that they do care about the pastoral needs of their students and do try to guide them in terms of more responsible alcohol consumption. There are other people that I would mention, the likes of Drink Aware, some retailers, and certainly the Public Health Agency, who are trying to play their part in what seems like a disjointed process. So, as I say, I do believe that where we have the health service a burden coming on them from these alcohol-related crimes, I also think that further down the line, the Justice Department and their associated agencies are also having to deal with the fallout from these incidents that are alcohol-induced. And I'm talking about the Youth Justice Agency and the Probation Board, for example, and in more serious cases, the Prison Service. And that's to be highly regretted that, again, scant resources in our budget are have to be spent on needless crimes. I came to the Assembly in May last year, having spent 19 years working in grassroots projects, and I do believe that we will only see a reduction in alcohol-related crimes when the strategy is developed and fed up through the grassroots. And to this end, I think that, unlike what is being proposed here this evening, as such, in terms of it being led from the Department of Justice in collaboration with the Health Department, I think that the policing and community safety partnerships, which are facilitated within the 11 councils, should be the structures through which any such strategy would flow. And I mean that in the sense that, you know, the strategy for Enniskillen would possibly be very different to the one for South Belfast. And I think that the people who are around the table, like the Prison Service and Probation and even Social Services...
Will the member give way?
Yes.
I appreciate the member giving way. Would you also agree with me that whilst there's clearly a cost to health and justice, there are very significant issues, for example, highlighted by Mr. Beattie about education, clearly a role also for the Department of Communities, and it is simply not a matter of solely two departments to deal with it.
Member has an extra minute, thanks to the benefit of the experience of our former party leader.
I hadn't noticed the time. Oh, thank you. No, I totally agree, and that's my point. I think that there's a lot of statutory agencies out there already doing this work, and they're to be applauded and supported on this. So the other reason why I would be hold a wee bit of reservation around this is that in the 8 months that I've been in the Assembly, and with particular reference to being the health spokesperson, I have heard of so many strategies that are at various stages of development and implementation with little or no funding to deliver upon them. And without fear of contradiction, I would say that there are many people out there in the community sector who would feel that they would have very little faith in the fact that if another strategy was produced by this Assembly, that it would necessarily have the desired effects and outcomes. So I will
ask the member to draw remarks to the conclusion.
I support the motion, however, I do think it would need a wee bit more work. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I also welcome the opportunity to rise as the Ulster Unionist Party health spokesperson tonight. I also welcome the fact that this is enabling us as elected politicians to focus on the issues which directly affect society in Northern Ireland, to put the practical before the political, which is what we are after all elected to do. Mr. Deputy Speaker, alcohol remains our favourite drug, and its continued misuse has a real and lasting negative impact on individuals, on families, on children and on communities, on our health system, on the criminal justice system, on the economy and on our society as a whole. These aren't my words, Mr. Deputy Speaker, but those of former Health Minister Edwin Poots, when in 2014 he penned the foreword to Every Contact Counts, improving access to treatment for alcohol misuse in Northern Ireland. So in order to significantly reduce alcohol-related crime, as the motion states, we need to know the starting point, and this document, albeit from 3 years ago, contains a number of startling and frightening revelations surrounding the burdens which alcohol has on our health service and on the justice system. The PSNI confirmed through the Northern Ireland Crime Survey 2012 that alcohol played a part in 19% of all recorded crime, and my colleague Doug Beattie referred to that earlier, almost a fifth, and I understand from the most recent statistics that this has changed little in the years since. Figures also show that 11% of antisocial behaviour in Northern Ireland was alcohol-related, and alcohol was also involved in 59%, a startling 59% of all domestic violence when an injury occurred. That should be enough to send a shiver down the spine. Now, I have spoken in length in this House on previous occasions about domestic violence and the devastating impact it has on families, ripping them apart, affecting young people at the very beginning of their young lives. In looking at this issue, it would be useful to receive more up-to-date figures from the Justice Minister. However, the point I'm making here is that this information has been known for some years. The link between overconsumption of alcohol and crime does not need to be proven or recognised. It's a clear fact. Ask any of our constituents who contact us, often at the end of their tether, because of problems they and their families are experiencing. Incidents often starting as a nuisance, but the problems escalating to more dangerous and potentially life-threatening levels as time passes. I have been assisting communities through the Housing Executive who have seen instances of alcohol abuse and related crime increase, and I pay a particular tribute to the assistance which the PSNI have provided in those instances. Important reassurance and a visible presence is extremely important for community confidence and reassurance. But we need to be conscious that this deflects resources from other areas and uses all, because some individuals choose to abuse alcohol, and it often doesn't stop there. So looking at the overall impact of alcohol-related harm on the health service, I have seen estimates that the cost is up to £900 million every year, roughly one-tenth of the entire block grant. The annual cost of alcohol misuse to health and social care sector alone is estimated to be around £250 million. Which means alcohol abuse costs every person in Northern Ireland £500 a year, which, with extreme health care costs continuing to rise by approximately 9% a year. Again, all contained within the document I referred to earlier, which was forwarded by the then Health Minister in 2014. So it's for others to answer, given the facts that we've known for some years, as to why this issue has not been tackled head-on, and indeed why the draft PFG contains only one reference to tackling poverty and disadvantage and reducing the negative impacts on alcohol and drugs use, with no specific reference made to alcohol-related crime. I think looking in on this debate from the outside, Mr Deputy Speaker, the public would be surprised if the Ministers of Health and Justice were not already working together on this issue.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
Or perhaps not. Thank you.
Thank you. I call the Minister of Justice, Ms Claire Sugden, to respond to the debate. And Minister, you will have up to 15 minutes.
Mr Deputy Speaker, I am sure that the Assembly readily recognises the proven link between crimes and the overconsumption of alcohol. And if it's the last thing we do on this dreadful day for Northern Ireland, it's that we debate an issue that affects people's lives, because goodness knows when we will have an opportunity again to represent the current concerns that matter to the people of Northern Ireland. While I appreciate the sentiment coming from Mr Easton and Mr Douglas to highlight an issue that none of us in this chamber, if they were here, could disagree with, I think it's clear by the events of the day and the emptiness of this chamber that practical issues, as Ms Dobson's rightly said, are of no concern to the people who wish to play politics. But I do welcome the opportunity to demonstrate what my department is doing in terms of tackling the issue of misuse of alcohol. Already my department is working with the Department of Health, and again I agree with Mr Beattie that that should be extended not just within the two departments of justice and the Department of Health, but education and indeed right across the executive that regrettably no longer exists. To tackle the complex issues that arise when excessive alcohol is consumed will require support funding, but again, the dissolution of this Assembly is going to make access to that funding across all departments more problematic. I'm happy to tell the House that there is already in place a joint strategy with the Minister of Health. The new strategic direction was established to address many of the concerns raised in the motion today on a cross-departmental basis with the Department of Health. But again, Mr Deputy Speaker, it feels fruitless standing in an empty chamber with the prospect of an election around the corner where we cannot put in, or we cannot fulfil the aims that we promised when we came into office less than a year ago. Although the new strategic direction is led by the Department of Health, my department and others within the criminal justice system, including the PSNI, the Northern Ireland Prison Service, the Probation Board and the Youth Justice Agency, all provide major contributions to the strategy and its implementation. The latest statistics produced for the annual report included feedback on analysis which showed that of persons arrested and brought to police custody suites, 46% of those arrested had declared that they had consumed alcohol recently before an arrest. These statistics also show that between the hours of 10 p.m. and 6 a.m. on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, this percentage rose to 77%. Particular reference was made to the fact that in over half of the arrests for offences where assaults were a factor, alcohol had again been consumed prior to arrest. Ms Bradshaw alludes to the recent campaign by the PSNI in relation to the One Punch campaign. This is an issue that does affect people on a very real basis, and I think it ruins people's lives on a day-to-day. And I think that's something that we cannot become complacent about. Mr Beattie alluded to the Dolan family. And if I can just say that I want to put on record my sincere sympathies to the Dolan family and what they have been put through. And indeed, had I been able to serve a longer time in this office, I would have looked at addressing that particular concern, particularly around sentences and how we look at the unduly nature of those and what we as an Assembly do have the power to change. But, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I hate to reiterate it, those opportunities are being lost. Those opportunities are being lost with what is being played out in this building today and these institutions. In addition to help monitor the position and support of their work with health partners to address the problem, the PSNI has been maintaining a statistical record of certain crimes and offences where alcohol and drugs intake is seen as a contributory factor. These figures, though modest, show welcome improvements in such links. In 2014-15, alcohol was a contributing factor in 19% of all crimes recorded and in 43% of offences of violence against the person. In replying to this motion, I am focusing today on my work of the Department of Justice to tackle alcohol-related crime, but tackling alcohol misuse generally is an issue for the Northern Ireland Executive, not just my department alone, which is why the new strategic direction is led by the Department of Health and why they have many initiatives underway, including looking at pricing and promotions, as mentioned earlier, access and availability, education work, as well as understanding the hidden harms caused by alcohol misuse. Members may be aware that the fourth annual report of the progress towards achieving the aims of the strategy was published in August of last year. And as part of the new strategic direction strategy, key links have been made between phase two of the new strategic direction, the community safety strategy, the strategic framework for reducing offending, and alcohol licensing. At a local level through the strategy, we continue to promote joined-up work between drug and alcohol coordination teams, policing and community safety partnerships, and local councils. Officials in my department and those partner bodies I listed have been looking closely at the range of concerns linked to abuse and the misuse of alcohol and indeed drugs, with the intention of reducing the public health and societal impacts that behaviours such as overconsumption of alcohol can lead to. Members may find it helpful to be reminded that the new strategic direction does not look to reduce crime where alcohol and drugs play a part, but also seeks to prevent and intervene early in matters relating to alcohol and both prescription drugs misuse and the use of illegal substances. In addition, the strategy looks to enable alcohol and drug users to have access to appropriate and effective treatment and support services, backed up by measures designed to reduce harm, supported by research and monitoring of trends and developments. The work in this area, led by the Department of Health, is producing results, and I am pleased to acknowledge that my department plays in supporting the work to address the range of these problems. The approach that I have encouraged since taking up the post last year is built upon problem-solving justice, which is a person-centred approach to tackling offending, if only my executive colleagues would take the same attitude. For me, problem-solving justice is at the heart of our new draft programme for government, if it will ever see the light of day, and is an approach that would drive our reforms over the next 5 years. And it is so unfortunate that we are to be distracted from this imaginative attempt at addressing problems being discussed today, because there was a real opportunity to start changing people's lives. I think, too, that the effort expended on the draft programme for government, which includes plans to have a safe community where we respect the law and each other, will have been seen by those suffering from the effects of alcohol-related crime to have been a wasted opportunity to tackle some of the issues that affect people on a day-to-day. My vision for the justice system in Northern Ireland was one of transformative change, because I believe it is much more effective to address the underlying causes of offending when they arise, whether they are alcohol-related or due to misuse or abuse of other substances, rather than to seek and treat the problems later. And I am so disappointed not to be able to develop these transformative changes throughout the current mandate. I believe that by diverting individuals where appropriate to the relevant community support and services in a timely manner, where they can receive targeted support and therapeutic intervention, we would deliver positive outcomes for vulnerable individuals and for communities, and for the criminal justice system as a whole, as well as reducing the number of victims. And I hope that kind of thinking can be sustained to ensure that the right help is made available to the right people. The programme for government creates the platform for such a change, and problem-solving justice provides the delivery mechanism. And as part of the problem-solving justice approach, we were developing a portfolio of initiatives, some of which may have directly impacted on alcohol-related crime, including multi-agency support hubs to support vulnerable individuals and their families, the development of a substance misuse court and a family drugs and alcohol court. With regard to the link between alcohol and crime, I think we all accept that the relationship between consumption, and particularly overconsumption of alcohol and drugs and some criminal activity, is well established. And in the latest new strategic direction update report, research appears to suggest that the consumption of alcohol and drugs is a contributing factor in a large proportion of all crime. And I know the Police Service of Northern Ireland is also acutely aware of these problems. Within my own department, local community safety partnerships have identified where the misuse of alcohol has been reported as playing a part in the behaviour and criminal activities in their areas. In trying to address this, they too expend money, time and effort to draw attention to the local concerns and work with their communities to identify, create and implement community programmes designed to help engender more responsible behaviour. Many of the local programmes are targeted at providing advice to students and young people through engagement programmes within schools, awareness seminars and targeted interventions to challenge, for example, on-street drinking. PCSPs work alongside local partners to coordinate support and lead the delivery of localised responses designed to effectively support tackling alcohol and drugs-related offending. And I fear much of this good work may also be affected by the dissolution of the Assembly next week, and the continuing absence of a budget which would give greater clarity and assurances to those trying to work in this area. Mr Deputy Speaker, I have another few pages to talk about, but again I do feel me standing here in front of the Assembly to an extent is fruitless, because I think the work that we have looked at over the past 8 months will be lost in what we need to do to take Northern Ireland forward. So I do appreciate the opportunity to speak on this motion. I appreciate to speak on a motion of an issue that does affect people's day-to-day lives. And I do think, on this really sad day for Northern Ireland, it's important that we put that message out there, because perhaps that demonstrates a little bit of hope for our country. And I do appreciate all the contributions to my debate. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr Paul Frew to wind up the debate on the motion, and you have up to 10 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And I rise to support my colleague Alex Easton for bringing forward this motion here tonight, a motion of real substance, of real politics for real people. And I stand here tonight heartbroken. And actually, I'm here and prepared to say that I back the Justice Minister and everything that she said there 100%. Because like me, I know, having worked with the Justice Minister over these past few months, that she was doing a good job. She was making real progress in that department. That would have benefited people, some of our most vulnerable people. And I know, looking around this chamber tonight, I know we don't always get filled chambers for debates, even of this nature, but I can look round this chamber tonight and I can see people, genuine people, who are here to do the best for their people, the people of Northern Ireland. Every single one person in this chamber feels the way I do, feels that they want to make a difference to their society. And they have been deprived, robbed, of the chance and the opportunity to make our people's lives better. This is just one of the issues we should have been debating today. And whilst we all know this is a bare pit of a chamber, and I like the rough and tumble, I must admit, I like the debates that we've had here over the last number of months. We were able to debate and be harsh if we needed to be, say our truths if we had to, but we were able to get something done, or at least speak about what needs to be done. But now that has been deprived of us, even that has been deprived of us by the actions, I believe, of one party. Because whilst most parties disagreed with my party on this issue and on these issues, they were prepared to say their piece, put down their authority where it was, tell it as it was, as they believed it was, and see it out. See it out. But yet we have now one party that has walked away and failed the people of Northern Ireland. We are here, we are elected to this House to represent people, not to walk away and not to resign. Alcohol-related crime is a massive issue in our society. We can talk about drugs and the harshness of drugs and why we shouldn't take drugs, and most people will get that. But alcohol is mainstream, so we have to treat it differently. We have to do something else. And that's the reason why it costs so much, because it's mainstream. I think we've all lived through our lives and we all look back, and you have to really concentrate how alcohol has actually affected us growing up and the things we've seen. And we've all been in a place where we've seen somebody a wee bit worse for wears. That's how we say it. And, you know, we try our best to get that person home to make sure they're safe, but, you know, there'll be a few jokes about, there'll be a few jibes and one thing and another. We find that acceptable at times. But we make sure that somebody gets home safe and hopefully things will be slept off and right as rain the next day. But it's the risks that that brings on. I can remember growing up and a neighbour, you just knew by the way things were talked about in the household and in my neighbour's household where I ran about with young friends in that house, and you knew there was issues there at night. You heard it through the walls, and it was drink unjust. And it's not only the person who takes the drink that we should be looking at. It's the family circle. It's the young people that sees that on a nightly basis. And it's scary. I've been in houses when I was young, maybe even staying over, and one of the parents come home drunk. And it's quite intimidating. It's quite scary. You've never really seen them in that light before. You wonder if everything's going to be okay. So drink, as whilst it's mainstream, it is a massive issue for us as a society. We've had figures bandied about, and of course we can all recognise those figures. I understand that it's a societal problem, so the whole executive should tackle this. But I suppose, where does the cost really, where's the burden really hit? It hits in justice and it hits in health, probably more so than anything else. And I suppose that's where they should lead, those ministers should lead any sort of strategy going forward. And I would support that. But we look at the work that we are trying to do. Look at the work the Justice Minister has been doing on domestic violence. And a lot of that is drink induced. And now this Justice Minister will not be able to move forward with her plans, with her legislation on this very issue. Now, isn't that a shame? It's a shame for the people of Northern Ireland who needs our help. The people who have a drink problem, the people who have a problem with drink, which is different, and the people, the family members in the society out there who suffer because of drink. Think of the assaults on police officers, on firefighters, on ambulance workers because of drink. People out doing a duty, doing a day's work, maybe a night's work, and the way they're treated, because people take too much drink and don't make decisions, the right decisions. I have a private member's bill sitting ready to go. I launched a consultation today on bringing accident emergency staff and workers into line with those services to make tougher sentencing for assaulting them. The amount of abuse and assaults that our accident emergency staff take because of people who have too much drink in our accident emergency rooms is woeful. It's a disgrace in our society. It's a tarnish on our name. And we need to do something about that, and now we can't. It is an absolute shame that here tonight we are talking and we don't really have any power. None of us. We can say what we like, we cannot make an effect. We cannot cause something to become better. Our chances are gone. In summing up, Doug Beattie raised a lot of issues and he focused on drink driving, rightfully so, because it's something I haven't mentioned yet, and the spectre of drink driving and how people can think it's acceptable to jump into a car intoxicated and drive somewhere, and even to not be able to make an informed decision or the right decision in that regard, I think is completely unbelievable. And he's right. Every time that happens, there's a risk of a death or more. And I just find that something that we should be looking at seriously. I do press release after press release about speed on or roads and about a bad bend and about driver behaviour and about how roads are dangerous. Well, roads aren't really dangerous. It's the people on the roads that are dangerous and how they drive. And that's something we need to get through. We need to get education and awareness into the very hearts and souls of our people to tell them that whilst this is mainstream, this is how much it's costing. And it's not just pounds and pence. It's lives. And what struck me about Doug Beattie's contribution, of course, Doug's former life was a soldier. And like me, he will know the practices in our armed forces with regards to drink and the lads all going out when they can get R&R and everything else. And again, it's not only an issue in the army, it's an issue right across society. And it's something we have to tackle. Something we have to educate and be responsible about. Yes, yeah, I will. Yeah.
I thank the member for giving way. And would he join with me in commending the PSNI for their excellent campaign at Christmas? I have to say that even as just a member of the public, I was stopped on two occasions in one night and breathalysed on both occasions. Thankfully, it had returned 000. I don't know who would have been more shocked if it had demonstrated anything different. But it just highlights, you know, that type of enforcement works, and I believe they need to be commended on the hard work and expertise that they put in this Christmas.
I thank the member for giving for making that contribution, and I hope it wasn't anything to do with her driving, and as opposed to the driving the campaign. But it was a very good campaign, and she is absolutely right to raise that because it did make a difference. People were talking about it. And I was stopped, although I didn't get breathalysed. I was actually stopped at checkpoint, so you're absolutely right. Paula Bradshaw raised the One Punch campaign. I have friends. I have a friend who has now got health issues and has had health issues probably for the last 20 years because he was a victim of a one punch attack. And that, again, was drink-induced with regards to the violent conduct on that night.
Ask the member to draw his remarks to a close.
So again, I echo everything the Minister has said. I echo everything Alex Easton has said, the mover of the motion, and I commend this motion to the House, Mr Speaker.
Thank you. Order. The question is, did the motion standing on the order paper be agreed? All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. Item 6 on the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly on this momentous day do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.